senior FBI official and MSNBC contributor. What did, you've seen that whole interview with Phil Barr, and he seems to be rebutting a lot of it, but would you do a fact check for us, please, on some of the allegations that he made?
Let me be clear on bias. I look to Bob Mueller in tremendous regard and respect for him, and I think he has the right take on this. Let me explain. There are policies in the Department of Justice that preclude charging the president. The rationale for those policies is that you don't want to stigmatize the president or burden the presidency. And so Bob Mueller thought, and I think properly so, that you can't charge a president, nor can you recommend charging the president, because that would also stigmatize the presidency and burden the presidency. And so I understand what Bill Barr is saying. I just happen to think that he's wrong.
And in terms of him saying also in that interview that he did not think that there was any way to establish criminality or an obstruction case, you have hundreds and hundreds of former prosecutors who signed a letter saying that they could have prosecuted that case.
That's right. And
so, were you not the president?
This notion that he was in there failing for work and then had a vendetta against the back is at that 7 months.
And thanks for keeping it clean, Chuck Rosenberg, as always. And if you haven't listened to MSNBC's newest original podcast, The Oath, with Chuck Rosenberg, make sure you check it out this week. Chuck speaks with former U.S. Deputy Attorney General Sally Yates. The Oath is for free wherever you get your podcasts. And coming up here, Rigged, new evidence about why the Trump administration put the citizenship question on the census. You're watching Andrew Mitchell reports on MSNBC. New evidence about the Trump administration's plan to add a citizenship question to the census shows Republicans are hoping it would help them change how voting districts are drawn and create an electoral advantage for the GOP and non-Hispanic whites, not to uphold the Voting Rights Act as suggested by the claim. Joining now is Victoria DiFrancesco, a professor at the LBJ School of Public Affairs at the University of Texas, also an MSNBC political contributor, and NBC News Justice correspondent Pete Williams. Pete, tell us about the backstory.
Well, this is what the ACLU says is new evidence that came from computer materials left over after a longtime Republican consultant died. His name is Thomas Hoffler. His daughter found this material. And the ACLU says it shows that he was the brains behind this request by Congress to include the citizenship question in the census form. He thought that
citizenship data
would help Republican legislatures more carefully and surgically draw districts for state legislatures and Congress to the advantage of Republicans and the disadvantage of Latinos who tend to vote Democratic. They say that he gave all of this material to an advisor to Commerce Secretary Ross, and that he actually helped draft what became the letter proposed to the Justice Department asking for the question to be included to help better enforce the Voting Rights Act. So they say two witnesses from the administration who testified at a trial on the census question in New York gave misleading testimony. The judges scheduled a hearing for next Wednesday about that. And in the meantime, the ACLU was notified the Supreme Court, which of course heard the census case last month.
And Victoria,
how
can this impact, what is the political impact? Let's say that they don't win the case. What is the import of what has been done with these census data? Right, so all of the evidence that we have in terms of survey work is that there is going to be a tremendous undercount of immigrant-based populations, namely Hispanics and Asians here in the United States. In terms of the political implications, let me take the case of Texas, my home state, as an example. We've been seeing over the past two election cycles, Democrats, mainly through the push of the early Latino electorate, make gains. We're still a very red state, but Hillary Clinton only lost by single digits, which is a big deal in 2016. We saw Beto O'Rourke come very close. We saw a number of states live in the Texas legislature and also in Congress. So if we end up with a very gerrymandered, uber-Republican map, 2020 forward, we're going to see these gains likely halted or pushed back. And we're going to see similar political implications across the board. And let me just note, Andrea, that a rising tide lifts all boats, and by contrary, don't cut your nose to spite your face. Because if we have less funding because of an undercount, it's not just Latinos that are going to be hurt. It's everyone who uses CHIP, Medicaid, funding for foster kids. So it might hurt Latinos in the electoral space, but in the funding space, it hurts us all. And Pete, what is the prospect for the Supreme Court? The arguments have already been made before the court. Do they consider additional information or not?
It's a technical matter. There's no way to say, oh, by the way, at the Supreme Court. After the argument, the Chief Justice says the case is submitted. That's it. This was never in the record. So it's always tricky to try to sort of knock on the Supreme Court door afterward and say, please pay attention to this, too. Nonetheless, the ACLU has raised this. The Justice Department, by the way, has responded. They say these accusations are baseless, that the people who wrote the letter that came from the Justice Department have never heard of this study, and they're completely rejecting it. They say they'll file a detailed answer on Monday, and undoubtedly, they'll tell the Supreme Court about their thing, too. But this does occur. If the accusation here is that this was entirely based on Republican politics, the question might some of the Republican justices, Republican appointed justices on the Supreme Court think twice about whether they want to have a 5-4 partisan split on this issue? It raises a kind of a yeasty question beyond just the law.
Indeed, and Victoria, they claim that this was to help enforce the Voting Rights Act. So if it were, done because of this gerrymandering and very deliberately racially motivated partisan applications, and that is even more disingenuous to not just lie about it, but to try and say you're kind of help in first the voting rights act, which many people argue was seriously damaged in 2013. Right, so the release of these documents just makes it harder and harder for the administration to stick to this theory that it's about the Voting Rights Act, because the question is, does the cost of an undercount outweigh the benefit of securing the Voting Rights Act? But when these documents show that there's a deliberate intent of suppressing the Latino vote by hacking and cracking it, it just makes it really hard to keep a straight face and make this argument. Victoria DeFrancesco, thank you so much. Pete Williams, as always, thank you. And coming up, Battle of Waterloo. What African-American voters in one key Iowa city say they want to hear from the 2020 candidates. MSNBC's Tremaine Lee has that story next, right here on their digital reports. Concentration of African Americans in the state, and has some insights to share.
Every national looking forward to that very valuable, very important Iowa voter. Sometimes it feels like by default it's white voter. A lot of them don't realize they're actually black people in Iowa.
There are many times where black people don't feel important and we don't feel heard. So to have someone step up and make us feel like we count, that matters, especially with my age group, because we're not into politics as much as we should be. We want our voices to be heard. It's very, very important. We want to know what our families are doing.
For me, and I think for a lot of my community,